Hello, everybody. It's Decentralized Dave, and this is the second part of my presentation aimed to break down the crypto markets as of June 2024. In my first part, I covered about 15, between 10 to 15 various bullish arguments. But I will have also specifically bearish arguments in this part of the presentation. However, before I get to the bearish arguments, I still would like to show you some bullish ones, and especially those connected to the alt season, because alt season is a topic that I started talking about at the end of the previous one. So let's go to it. Before I get to the alt season, however, I would like to show you another Bitcoin bullish indicator, which is the ratio between Bitcoin market cap and the open interest. So this is a very important ratio, and I am watching it very closely. I have been talking about it quite a few times in my FaceTime series, and that series is also my track record. I have been doing it since November 2022, and the first time part of the series was called Crypto Screaming Buy. But I also had some bad calls in the process. However, those that were good, I was able to read well as well from this indicator. This is very important indicator for me, and I believe I can also read it reasonably well. So what this shows is how much leverage on the Bitcoin is out there at the moment opened comparing to its market cap. And when that ratio, in my experience, when it gets over 1.7, we are basically over-leveraged. And the situation is then very dangerous because every single time, except for a very tiny few times, the leverage is long. Okay? It's very rare that people are shorting en masse. Very rare. Once it gets too high, like for instance, here where we were at 1.8. This is August 2023. If you remember, also in my FaceTime series, I was adamantly bearish. I was even calling for below 10,000 Bitcoin in the July and August 2023. I was that much bearish. I actually exited the markets in July, August 2023. And but what we did get was only 25K, but also altcoins plummeted way more. Altcoins, many of them made cycle lows, like Chromia, for instance. Many made cycle lows in the autumn 2023. So it was tremendously good call looking back to be that much bearish in July and August 2023. And I was able to do that call also based on this because I saw the ratio was high. Look at how high the ratio was here. This is in 2021. Right here. Okay, this is a sample from 2021. And look at how high the ratio was here. This was April 2021. That was the top. That was a Bitcoin top. And also April 2021, as I've covered in my first part of the presentation, many, many indicators, many data were adamant and were clearly showing that this is the title, this is the cycle top. You know, April 2021 was the cycle top. And just look at how high, how much leverage was there. And what happened then? Then we went from 65K or so, we went to 48K or so. And then we had an alt season that was brief, as alt season always, alt seasons always are. And after the few weeks, actually, we started declining. But look how still high this ratio was. And if I had only seen that as the Bitcoin was going down in May 2021, as it was already declining from 60,000 to 40,000, and the amount of leverage based comparing to its market cap was only going up. If I had seen this back then, I would have definitely decided differently because this spells big trouble, and that ultimately came. There was then one day, black day for hundreds of thousands of traders in 2021 when everybody got liquidated, when Bitcoin cascaded from 40,000 to 30,000 and altcoins cascaded even more aggressively. And however, what I want to show you as well as is that once these cascades happen, we have the drop in this rating. We have the drop in the ratio of Bitcoin market cap versus open interest. And after that drop happens, that usually marks the bottoms, at least local bottoms. And this is also, this helped me tremendously the last year, because in September, I saw a big drop in this ratio. I saw big, lots of long leverage liquidated there. And I was like, huh, wait a second, like, this is actually bullish. Like this is making people defensive as we speak. And what happens when people are defensive? What happens when people are positioned for the more downside? What happens pretty much every single time? And I actually started turning very bullish in September 2023, and this metric helped me. And the final conclusion about from this reading, from this data, that applies for the current situation, that the ratio is low. We have 1.4, even though we went up from 1.3 recently, from when we went from 60 to 70K, we went up from 1.3 and we are now 1.4, but it's still low. So this is very, very good bullish, actually. Okay, Google Trends. So here I'm featuring three samples of four different keywords, okay, to show you the Google Trends. So right here in the top right of the screen, we have the short term past 12 months only for meme coins. At the bottom of the screen, we have a short term, which is past 12 months only for Bitcoin. Excuse me. And to the left of the screen, we have a long term. We have a 5 years of the history of Bitcoin and Ethereum. So what are the conclusions taking from these samples, and what does this data actually show? So I'm going to be talking about meme coins because I have concerning things to show you and to tell you. But this is actually bullish even for meme coins, because it shows that according to Google Trends, the current meme season is only 58% strong comparing to the March meme season. We've already been in the March season. So this is actually even bullish for even meme coins at the very moment. At least this data shows that. Then for Bitcoin, it's tremendously better. And Bitcoin is at 69,000 at the moment of recording of this video. And we have only 32% strength of the keyword in the Google. Keyword Bitcoin is only 32% off the where it was back in March, when Bitcoin was 74K. Bitcoin is just 5,000 lower in price. And the search term Bitcoin is used only 32% of the times as it was when it was just 5,000 higher. So this is very bullish for Bitcoin. Very. Now, if you want to zoom out and check the Google trends for over the past 5 years, this is yet another data set that is showing that was the top, because Bitcoin and also Ethereum peaked actually in the spring 2021. And where are we today comparing to this peak? Bitcoin was on 16% of its previous high, and Ethereum 12-13%. So it's actually even worse than Bitcoin. Bitcoin is at 16%, and just out of the top of my head, like, Ethereum is like 13% or so. So this is obviously very bullish. And the topic we've all been waiting for, alt seasons. So let's talk about the alt seasons, and actually there I will also conclude in few more slides, I must add, but I will conclude the bullish arguments. So alt seasons, first of all, I have to stress to you that alt seasons historically have been actually excellent exit points, because after every single alt season came crash. And the alt season marked either the cycle tops or some kind of local tops, but it was still worth to sell there, even if it was a local top. Let me give you three examples of the three most recent alt seasons. The most recent alt season was in May 2021. If you remember, Bitcoin was only sideways. It came back from 65 to 48 and then came back to 60, but it didn't make new all-time highs. And in the meanwhile, Ethereum doubled, Cardano doubled, Doge was up in the stratosphere, Maker, MKR, doubled or so. Many altcoins doubled. What happened after that? This is the total market cap. This is the total one. Big liquidation cascade. Okay, I've mentioned the liquidation cascade related to the over-leveraging few slides ago. So that's this candle right here. It's May 2021. Then the alt season before that was September. This is a mistake. This is 2020. I made a spelling mistake here. September 2020 is this chart from. This is the DeFi summer, guys. If you remember DeFi summer, it was again like Bitcoin was actually from the middle of the summer was kind of declining, but DeFi's were going like you had the DeFi craze pretty much or similar like we have a meme craze right now. I'm gonna get to it, but everybody chasing DeFi, everybody wanting to go into any DeFi, everybody doing some yields and the new DeFi that were pure like the first DeFi's they at least did something, but then started coming some DeFi's that were just a white paper or a picture or a ticker, and even they got market cap. And what happened after that? September 2020. Which was a DeFi big correction, 75%. The DeFi coins went down, but altcoins in general went down a lot. Even Bitcoin went down. This is a total market cap. So as you can see, pretty nasty red candles here in September. So to sell the DeFi summer was an excellent move for those that were able and were good enough to do it. And the biggest last season we have seen ever was the ICO craze, right? In January, December 2018. So here again, Bitcoin was just retesting its all-time high. It was actually already past its 20,000 mark. Bitcoin peaked in December 2017. But for a few weeks after that, like altcoins were going like everything, and there were so many multiples. Like this was a very, very crazy time. What happened after January 2018? Well, that was the end of the cycle, right? And then in the following actually weeks was massive crash. Also, the altcoin index is not showing that we have the alt season as of yet, or we had any, and that is obviously very bullish. And I've just mentioned Ethereum and the alt season, and I'm coming to this big, beautiful slide. And yeah, this is there. I have done some math on this slide. First of all, there are some quotes from the articles about Eric. He was also good to tracking the Ethereum spot ETFs because indeed, SEC made sure that the market was not aware that they were going to approve it. It was actually behaving like they were not going to approve it. And it was very likely intentional to suppress the prices of Ethereum and also other altcoins, right? The spot ETFs of Ethereum were approved. And the trading will start, according to Balkunas, the trading will start end of June, launch alleged possibility. But he also says that it could be still the first days of July. So end of June, start of July is very likely we will see the start of the training for Ethereum spot ETFs. Okay. Now, this is the Hong Kong spot crypto ETF. And then you can see like the Ethereum inflows are pretty much minority comparing to the Bitcoin inflows. And it is very likely perhaps even certainly going to be the case with the US inflows. However, let's do a math about how much should these inflows, these Ethereum inflows be? How large should they be? So let's think about it for a second. So Eric estimates 15 to 20% of those of Bitcoin inflows. Seyfarth, another analyst, however, he estimates 20 to 25% of Bitcoin inflows. So as you can see, the range is around 20%. Okay, so I am taking it into consideration 20% as the average possible expected inflows from the Bitcoin's inflows. But Ethereum only has 34% of the BTC's market cap. So if you think about that statement, you realize that for every $3 to move a Bitcoin price, for every $3, you need only $1 to move Ethereum's price as much. I've done the math for you. Okay, so I have taken this 20%, which is very reasonable and very neutral estimate of the Ethereum spot ETF's inflows. I multiplied it by 3, and I got a result that Ethereum spot ETFs are likely to move the price of Ethereum of about 60% of the price move of Bitcoin. Of course, there are other conditions in move, especially the equities being strong. But okay, like let's leave this all aside. Let's just focus on how much did the spot ETFs move the Bitcoin price and how much it can move the Ethereum's price. Now, based on that fact, BTC moved from 26K to 3049K prior to the start of the trading of Bitcoin spot ETFs. And moved further to 74K once the inflows to the of the Bitcoin ETFs actually started. So Bitcoin moved in total from the 26K to 74K, moved plus 184%. And now 60% out of it is 110%. Now the Ethereum started moving. The bottom of the recent correction in May for Ethereum was 2850 or about, and when you add 110%, you actually get $6,000 Ethereum, and this is the very neutral estimate, not optimistic, not Ethereum fanboy at all. This is very neutral, even if it is worse, even if the inflows are underwhelming. Ethereum is likely to go into the new all-time highs nonetheless, into the 5,000s. And this is very bullish, this slide, as obviously very bullish. I'm coming now into a really short-term indicators. This is just the current funding fees. They change every 8 hours. So this is like at this moment when I'm recording this video, I've taken the sample yesterday, and when I'm recording this video, it can be very, very different, but okay. The basic picture here, it shows you that Bitcoin is on $69,000, is worth $69,000, and the funding fees are beautifully neutral. There is a little bit on the OKX. Remember that basically all the Bitcoin leverage is on only on Binance, Bybit, and OKX. Like Deribit is not really, it's not really important. So, and especially Binance and Bybit, and they have bought beautifully reset neutral funding fees. So this is excellent news, and short term, very bullish. Because as long as these don't start rise, then the price has a room to go higher. As long as these get into higher numbers, 2, 3, 4, 5 in extreme cases, then the price just cannot move anymore and has to correct, has to go down, basically. Ethereum, even better. I am very shocked to see that people are not longing Ethereum yet. Also, very good is that we have a meme craze. I'm going to get into the memes soon in this part of the presentation. And Doge is neutral. Beautiful. And OKX is shorting Doge. I love that. I'm big in Doge, by the way, for the disclaimer. Also, other meme coins like Floki is reset. Wow. But Pepe is already fat. So a good, very bad news for Pepe. And rotation into Pepe right now is wrong. Let's put it that way at the very moment, okay? But I'm going to talk about it again. And I'm going to talk about it on this slide. Because also this is still bullish argument. PEPE just behaves this way. Every single time it moves in price, people start longing it. In February, it didn't discourage PEPE from growing. People were already longing it at the end of February, and PEPE made like 5x or 6x or 7x or so. Anyway, and made actually a couple of people, made hundreds of thousands, even millions on leverage, which is actually very wrong. And when market does it, it's sick. It's the market is unhealthy. It has a cancer. But of course, in the late stage of the bull market, the market can have a cancer and can let a few people slip away with free lunch, and only then crash, because it's also balancing. Market is balancing itself, because in the bear times, also market is also sick the other way. Like everybody is bearish and the market still is not picking up and sometimes goes even lower a bit. So there can be these anomalies. And I just wanted to put into perspective that last time people started longing PEPE exactly 1 month before it peaked. So right now it's actually about half of the month that people are longing PEPE. So it could be that PEPE will actually peak still 1 or 2 weeks from now. So it might still have a little upside. But even then, I stand by what I said in the previous slide, like you are doing a wrong thing to rotate into it, because you will just not be selling in 2 weeks. If you rotate into PEPE and let's say doubles, you will not sell pretty much. So this is just, just showing you, I'm talking about meme season the first time and points on meme correction end of June. First of all, how do you check, how do you know if the retail is crypto? There are a couple of ways. I'm going to bring you up one of them. I'm going to bring you up the data of how popular is Coinbase app in the App Store. In 2021, in October, basically 2021, Coinbase hits number one on Apple US App Store. So there you have it. The top of the retail was around at the very, very top of the market in October, November 2021. So how popular is it today? This is the sample from 5th of March. It was 44th. So I'm gonna very soon pay attention to this guy right here who claims with no data that there are no retail, like the good times are yet to come, like be bullish, don't worry, you know, you are still ahead, you're still early. That just to show you how much retail was around in March this year. A lot of retail was around March this year. But what about today? The app is ranked 200, back to 200. So looks good to me. And this is actually a bullish argument. And yeah, I've just mentioned this guy. He's saying it with no data. Like, oh my God. I think Bitcoin needs to break 100,000 for people to take notice again. So wrong. Okay, wrong. But the retail is at the moment not around, and that is bullish. And that was all the bullish arguments I had for you. I hope you enjoyed them. Let's now have a look at bearish arguments. So I think I have one kind of a macro bearish argument related to the economy and to the rate cuts. We had just this chart here. We had just a reading. We had just a report on the first quarter of the GDP growth in the US, Q1 2024. And it was only 1.3%. That is very underwhelming. It's the lowest reading in years when you don't count the negative recession growth in Q1 2022 and Q2 2022. When you don't count with that, this is the lowest reading in years. So this is not good. This is not nice. It means that the economy is slowing down, growth is slowing down, and it might lead to rate cuts. Crypto has seen in its existence two rate cuts. One in 2020 in March and another in 2019. And in both ways, just look, this is 2019 to all the way to Corona. This is Bitcoin's price. Just look what Bitcoin and also all cryptocurrencies, what it did when the rate cuts in August, September, October were happening. It was just going down. And then even, of course, well, during the COVID crash, of course, but it was only after the rate cuts actually happened. Yeah, the last rate cuts that lowered the rates to zero, but also together with a huge announced stimulus, it was actually the stimulus that most likely recovered the price so quickly from the Corona lows. Because obviously, if you print so much money into the circulation and just give free money, free casino chips to people in this big game, you know, called crypto, then of course they're gonna use these chips, right? They're gonna throw these chips at something. They're not just gonna keep them. So yeah, GDP was unexpected. Even it was expected more, and it might lead to rate cuts, and that might be bad news for crypto. This is another argument from CryptoCon. I used quite a few of his charts in the first part of this presentation, and the same I will do in this part of the presentation, because I do find many of his charts intriguing, very worthwhile, valuable as well, also clear to read, and also he's not spamming them. He's being thoughtful of what to say, what to release. This is all from his, obviously, this is from his free content that is publicly available. But he also has the premium content. If you want to check him out, then be my guest. You will find him on X. So here, this is a supply adjusted coin day destroyed. 14-day moving average of that. Because if you wouldn't use moving average, then you would have lots of noise. Like, so it's easier to read stuff once you use moving average. It flattens lines and it makes them easier to see, to read. And what this indicator actually shows is a long-term holders selling, okay? And the selling of the long-term holders reached the top levels. Also, what is very interesting here as well, that there was a massive, one of the largest recorded long-term holders sales were at the very bottom of 2018. And we also had the spike at the bottom of this cycle. So, and we didn't have any spike in the Corona. That's very interesting. Two cycles ago in 2015, we didn't have the spike. So this also sometimes shows you capitulation. That's also what I'm... This shows you, for once, the profit taking, when the long-term holders are taking profit, but also when they're capitulating. At the moment, since we are near all-time highs, they were definitely taking profits, because since we were in the all-time highs, they were all in the profits, right? This is from CryptoCon again. This is a Bitcoin long-term holders momentum, which also reached the cycle top zone. If you can see, this is the 3-week candle momentum. This is one of the indicators that, again, I will say it again, I will repeat myself, but also this indicator very clearly showed the top in the spring 2021, and just showed that the autumn 2021 was a fake top. And so where is that reading right now? Well, actually, it just reached the cycle top zone. However, there is one more element to this chart, and that is Bitcoin long-term holders 1 point over 1 year. So where do you usually have the start of the decline of the long-term holders? OK, Okay, it's very, very easy to see. Also, he also drew arrows here. So in 2013, it happened before the top was made. The decline of the holders, of 1 year holders, started before the first top was made. In 2017, it started like way before it started. Actually, in 2016, the decline in 1 year holders started in 2016. So way before the top was made. Then in the last cycle, when did the decline started? It actually started around the DeFi summer in September 2020, when the decline of Bitcoin long-term holders started. So it actually started in 2020, and then it took another half year or so to make actual to actually make the top. And right now the decline started at the end of 2023. So it started around it in a Q4. This green area, Bitcoin long-term holders decline, that is actually short-term still bullish, but the longer-term again bearish, and the 3 week candle momentum is one of the most bearish. Arguments, one of the most bearish data that I had to show you so far. This is Bitcoin weekly RSI. This chart shows clearly that we already are in a cycle top area in this purple area. Okay. Every single cycle, we basically came twice to the cycle top area and we were there once. And also, once we get into this purple area, he also calls it a cycle top parabola signal. So once we get into the gray area, it's like the parabolum, like the cycle is ending, like it's the parabolum is the beginning. And it's actually every single time when we get into this purple area is when we're breaking the all-time high in Bitcoin. And after that, then we made the first top that he marks as a blue dot. Then we retraced every single time we retraced. Sometimes we retraced significantly. Sometimes we retraced less, like in the last cycle. And then we came back and then we actually marked the cycle top. And I don't even have to say it again, but yet another indicator that was showing spring 2021 as the cycle top. Not. And actually, this is also a little too early indicator. Because in the last cycle, for instance, the second dot, it was actually it was about 58,000. It was, I think, in March. But the bull market still continued for about 2 months, where Bitcoin was grinding slowly lower and lower all-time highs, and then we had the Altseason, and only then we crashed. So this also can signal early. But we made our first top there, and now we're retracing, and presumably once we make the second top, then that is. According to this data, according to this chart, that is either a cycle top or a very significant top. Now I'm getting to the end of my presentation. I'm going to talk about sentiment, something that I like to focus on. So crypto sentiment. To the right of the screen, I'm showing you Q indexes. First is the index that probably everybody of you knows and uses, the widely spread, widely followed crypto fear greed index. And this is a new one from the CoinMarketCap. And the CoinMarketCap is, in my opinion, is superior because it was showing you, for instance, the last September, it was showing you a very obvious fear. And last September, we had very obvious fear. Last September, we had as perfect sentiment reset as it gets. Because the longs were liquidated, everybody started positioning for more downside, and everybody started talking about more downside. But this index is not showing such a good It's showing actually that we were hovering at 40, around 40. We were hovering around neutral levels, but that is actually wrong. It was lower. The sentiment was lower. So that's why I focus more on the CMC already. And that is now very conservative. It shows only 60 sentiment. The first one shows 73 already. This is bearish. But according to the CMC, I think it's just still neutral / bearish. It's just like, I would even say that this is not even bearish yet. Also, both of these indexes, this one was showing 90 extreme greed in March this year. And this one was showing also 90 extreme greed. Obviously, after such an extreme greed, a reset is needed. So then we had a correction. But was it enough of the sentiment reset? I see, for instance, here we only went to neutral. We didn't even go to greed, to fear. Doesn't seem promising. So, okay, I go out there and I just listen to the influencers and I just read their comments and I have a look at what people say on forums around me and I just put a picture together myself where the sentiment is. And what did I discover? Well, I actually discovered that the sentiment reset was not enough. That is my simple conclusion. Like this guy right here, like this is from the start of May, so it's relatively recent. Both of these are from the start of May. And he's just constantly, of course, shilling everything. And so Bitcoin going to 100K, Ethereum 10K, alt spam 12 a day, meme coins billions, yada, yada, yada. What he gets for a shills like that? He gets an applause. This is quite exciting prediction. Always trying to watch. And this is just one of the reaction that I just cherry picked for you. There are like hundreds or whatever. You just read it yourself. You're going to see like when today says something bullish, he just gets, yeah. Like, that's exactly, you know, we're all gonna win. And what about when a bear comes forward? So first of all, it is so hard to find any bears. That itself is terrible. Second of all, when I finally find one and I see even some arguments that is not crazy and it's actually could be like based on some data, like Bitcoin's ETF saw outflows in April and the ETF narrative is over. So like, it's not factually wrong. So what is he getting? Like, everybody is just angry with him. Like, hate. Like, you are still there? Like, yeah. Like, oh my God. Like, you are a clown. Bad wire. Oh my. And he just go down through his comments and you just see all of this. So my conclusion, simple conclusion, that the sentiment was not reset at all. And we probably will get the reset of the sentiment around the 50,000s. We have to push lower than we were at some point in the future. And that's probably going to be enough. And we have to stay there for a little bit. We can't just go to 50 and bounce immediately. We have to stay there. And it is my estimate that that is going to be enough. But of course, I will assess the situation there. For the moment, sentiment is one of the bearish stuff I see in crypto right now. This slide has convinced me to make this presentation in the first place. Over the past week, I cannot express myself enough how triggered I was to see all this of this clown fiesta. All the influencers, and this is not random bots with no name and no follower bots. These are all Twitter personalities. Just look at their view. Like this guy right here has 500,000 views on this tweet alone. Like, as you can see, 1,000 comments here, 1,000 comments here, 1,000 comments here, 1,000 comments here, I didn't even put but 1,000 comments here, probably 1,000 comments here, 1,500 comments here. And look what are all of them unilaterally yelling about? What are they all saying at the same time? Shill me a meme coin. Which hidden meme coin? Shill me some good ETH meme. Which tokens are you gonna get rich? And all meme coins as an options. All right, I'm gonna ape into meme coins. Who goes on like Pepe? Best meme coins below 50 million market cap. And trust me, I could make 10 more slides with 10 or 15 of these influencers on each slide. And this is not the same guys. Like the every single of these samples is from a different guy. And I could make 10 of these slides and it would still not be enough. This is how many of them are out there at the very moment. And they weren't out there like this a month ago when Pepe was 4 zeros and six or so. No. But they're out there now. So I have taken some conclusions. This is one of the most, this is the deep bearish thing I see out there actually at the very moment. This is en masse. This is a mass psychology. This is not one or two guys that are smart ahead of the flock and are going to make money on this. This is a mass psychology. All of these guys that you see, all of them are the flock. So if you follow any one of them or want to trade with them, then you are likely going to, at this very moment, you are going to likely actually lose. They started swarming around 20th of May. If you check one of these comments, one of these posts, and you see the comments that their flock gives them, it's just like this. It's just, this is the reaction to this, you know, this is the reaction. And if I retweet, because I was so triggered, I started retweeting many of them, criticizing, and I got some hate for that as well. So that's just yet another confirmation here that I'm likely right. If this cycle will continue to play out as it has been, then this could be precursor to the alt season actually. And this could mean that right now we have the meme season, but the meme season will end in June. And that's where the alt season and then after that, maybe end of June or maybe July. I don't know when, but maybe after that, the alt season could actually play out. So my conclusion, this is extremely bearish what I can see, but my conclusion is that this seems to be only isolated to the meme sector. So that is also a saving grace. And also the funding fees of Ethereum prove that. Like people are not longing Ethereum today for some reason. So that was the end slide, my last argument, and it's time to draw a conclusion, even though I told you pretty much part of the conclusion already. So when we were going through technicals, the technicals are extremely bullish. And right now, like total two and total three market cap, the altcoins, like that looks so bullish, very bullish. Sentiment is greedy. Sentiment is not good. With the meme season, extremely greedy, which signalizes correction at the very least in meme space. So yet again, here I am debating whether in the June, whether it's isolated only to the meme space or not. We were also, many data sets were showing very clearly that we already were parabolic this cycle. Q4 and Q1 2024 was parabolic, and the sentiment reset is needed since. But I do not find the sentiment reset as of yet. I find the sentiment reset in April incomplete. And that's why I am driving that there is need to return to 15 and 60k and stay there for some time, weeks, months, And only that will reset the sentiment, and even that will open the door for another cycle parabolum, because also there is a confluence of lots of the data sets that are showing that the cycle is far from done, and we might have a parabolum to get there. But in order to have one, the sentiment reset needs to be reset. And also that the sentiment reset could actually happen very shortly after the alt season, which is now looming. That was the conclusion. I hope you loved the all the data that I had to bring. I enjoyed presenting, and hopefully let's see you in the next quarter when I might update and bring you more.